Okay, good morning everyone. Welcome to the third week of Structural Graph Theory. And let's start with a quick recap of our short discussion of cycles and bonds from last lecture. Okay, so recall that cycles are non-empty even subgraphs. So what does this mean? This means that if C, supposing C is a cycle, if C is a cycle, then there does not exist any even subgraph D that is a proper subset of C, with the exception of the empty set, of course. So I have to make sure that D is not equal to empty. Okay, notice that if you take any cycle, inside the cycle, you cannot find another even subgraph except for the empty set, which is always there, right? So that is a way to define cycles. Of course, this is not the usual definition you might think of. You will probably think of the figure of a cycle. Another way to look at it, it's a connected two regular graph. A connected graph in which every vertex has degree 2. That's the same as a cycle. Okay? So we have a very nice visual understanding of cycles, which we will also... Yeah, go ahead.
So basically, we can say that connected two regular graphs and minimal non-empty even subgraph, they're both equivalent.
All right. I should probably say subgraph because we are talking about subgraphs of a graph. Yeah.
So connected two regular subgraph and... connected two regular subgraph and minimal non-empty even subgraph, they're equivalent basically.
They are the same, yeah. They are both cycles.
Yeah, they're both cycles, yeah. They are both cycles.
So the good thing about the right side is it gives a very visual description of cycles, right? The left side is a bit cryptic, one could say. But the right side is very clear what it should look like. Okay? In the same sense, bonds, we will define them, as we did last lecture, as minimal non-empty cuts of a graph. Okay? Minimal non-empty cuts. These are the bonds. Okay? So the definition is very similar, right? It's basically if you have a cut, which is a bond, if you have a bond, then you cannot find any smaller cut inside it, except the empty set, which is always there. Okay? What's the problem? As of now, we don't have a very nice visual description. Okay? So that's where we are going today. We will first get a very visual understanding of what bonds of a graph look like. Are there any questions or concerns regarding the definitions? Is the definition clear, Shefali?
Yes.
Okay. Anyone else? Anybody has any questions or concerns? Okay, so let's take one example. Consider the following graph.
So, sir, by here we minimal.
Yeah, go ahead.
We mean that they are all edgewise minimal.
Right, edgewise minimal. We are viewing them as sets of edges.
Sets of edges, and they are inclusion-wise minimal, basically.
Yeah, inclusion-wise minimal. That's right. Right. So I want you to look at this example. And I'm going to put some edges. I will put these edges in, let's say, well, actually, let me use the same color. Okay, so here I've got a graph, and I want you to look at this cut. The cut where these vertices are x, and these vertices are x bar. And all the edges that are going between these sets, that is our cut. Okay? So is this a bond? Does this look like a bond to anyone?
I think I have a characterization of bonds. So basically, so if we take any cut.
Yeah, so before you go there, what do you think about this example?
So basically, my point is that the induced subgraph on x and induced subgraph on x bar, they must be connected.
Okay, fine. So you are saying that this is not a bond.
This is not a bond, yeah. Because the induced subgraph on x is not connected. There's two components.
Okay. Any other answers? Okay. So you're right. Basically, you don't need to take all these edges. You can just take a subset of them. For example, you could take this edge. And you could take this edge and they form a cut, because you can think of this as y and the outside as y bar. And now what you have is a smaller cut contained inside partial x. And partial y is not empty. So this implies that partial x is not a bond. Okay, and the characterization you are thinking of is actually correct, and that is what we will prove. We will prove that a cut is a bond if and only if both the sides, what we call the shores of a cut, if they induce connected subgraphs. Before that, I need to tell you what an induced subgraph is. So, induced subgraph.
Sir, can you repeat the characterization?
Right. It's, you want both the sides to be connected. So if you look at the graph formed by x, induced by x, and the graph induced by x bar, they both should be connected. I will write it down in a minute, once I write down the definition of induced subgraphs. Okay. So what's an induced subgraph? If you take a subset of the vertices, then the graph induced by x, this is the notation, subgraph induced by x is the subgraph of G whose vertex set is all vertices in x, and its edge set is all those edges of the graph, such that the edge has both ends in x. Okay, so you take the set of vertices x and you take all edges that are contained in the set x, so both the ends are in the set x. Okay, so if you look at our example, the graph induced by x is basically whatever you see on the left side without the edges that are going to the other side, right? So this is the graph induced by x, and this is the subgraph induced by x bar, but you have to throw away the edges going between x and x bar. Okay, and you can see what we did here. In order to choose the set Y, we basically took a component in this induced subgraph. And the reason we could do that is because we had at least two components. So we would not have been able to do this if both the sides were connected. And that actually turns out to be a characterization of bonds. Okay, so our next, let me state this theorem. 2.15, in a connected graph, a non-empty dot partial of x is a bond if and only if the graph induced by x and the graph induced by x complement are both connected. Okay, that's the characterization we are going to prove. Are there any questions or concerns regarding what this theorem is saying? Your graph is connected, then a cut is a bond if and only if both the shores of the cut are connected, or they induce connected subgraphs. Right? And by shores, I mean x and x bar.
I have a question.
Yeah, go ahead.
So why are we making the assumption that the graph G is connected in theorem 2.5, in theorem 2.15?
Right. So that's a good do-it-yourself. Why do you need connected? And can you generalize the result to disconnected graphs? So do we need the graph to be connected? And if so,
I think if the graph is not connected, then any if we take any non-empty cut, then that cannot be a bond. Because if the graph is not connected, then it has at least two components. Say right. Components are g1 and g2. So if we take any non-empty cut, partial of x. So since the cut is non-empty, so x is a non-empty proper subset of vertex set. Mm. And since x is a non-empty proper subset of vertex set, so
okay. So good, it's a good point. Think about it. So bonds do exist in disconnected graphs because they generate the cycle space. So you, I mean, so you will definitely have bonds.
I was trying to say, basically, if the graph is not connected, so it has at least two components. So if G has exactly two connected components, then we can say that exactly in the graph G, there is exactly one bond.
Why?
This is because, so if the graph is not, so if G has two components, say G1 and G2, okay, then say the vertex set of G1 be V1 and the vertex set of G2 be V2, then I think that partial of V1 is a bond. Either partial of V1 or partial of V2 must be a bond, because
they are empty, right? Partial of V1 and partial of V2 are empty. Bonds by definition are non-empty minimal cuts. Right, the empty set is not a bond.
Yes, sir.
Right. What about this? Why is this not a bond? These two edges. Anyways, I myself don't know the exact statement, but I'm pretty sure with small amount of effort, you can generalize this to disconnected graphs. Okay, so that's a good do-it-yourself exercise. Okay.
Sir, I think you can do for each of the connected components of G, you can take the bonds and take their union. That will be a bond.
That is a possibility, yeah. Mm-hmm. That is a possibility.
So if G has components say G1, G2, GK, where K is greater than or equal to 2, then if GI I consider a bond BI and take the union of BI, then that will be a bond in G.
Well, if you take the union, then you will have smaller bonds, smaller cuts that are contained in it. So you might want to think about more about that. Anyways, let's do it offline and okay. let everyone also think about this question, right? So is the question clear? Right? So this is, we are assuming the graph to be connected. So what happens if the graph is not connected? Can you get a similar characterization? Basically, you should be able to get one using this theorem itself. It should be a simple corollary of this theorem. Okay? Good. Any other questions or concerns? There is another way to think about induced subgraphs that I want to mention here. You can also put it as a do-it-yourself, but it's quite easy. A subgraph H of a graph G is an induced subgraph if and only if H can be obtained from G by deleting vertices. So you should never delete edges, you just delete vertices. Of course, when you delete a vertex, all the edges incident at that vertex will be automatically deleted, right? But you should never delete just an edge without deleting the vertices of that edge, okay? So this is another way to think about an induced subgraph. You just do vertex deletions and you will get your final graph. Such a subgraph is an induced subgraph. And you might want to compare this with spanning subgraphs. Spanning subgraphs are those graphs that can be obtained by just deleting edges. You never delete vertices because you have to keep all the vertices in a spanning subgraph. So you can compare this with a spanning subgraph. Okay? All right. If there are no other questions or concerns up to this point, we can proceed to proving this theorem. So let's look at the easy direction. Well, neither of them is too difficult, to be honest. So let us do the contrapositive. Supposing one of the two induced subgraphs is not connected, then we will show that the cut is not a bond. Okay? Suppose G of X, so G induced by the subgraph induced by X is not connected. Okay? So we have some cut, we have X here and X bar here, and we are assuming that this left side is not connected. So that means there are at least two components there. There could be more components, but I'm going to draw just two components. Okay. We need to show that partial of X is not a bond. So how do we go about this?
Sir, I have doubt. What if the other component does not participate in any edges towards X bar?
Right. Okay. So what if one of these two components, let's say I call this H and I call this J. We have at least two components. I am not caring about the other components, right? So you are saying that in one of the components, there are no edges going from this side to the other side. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
Okay. So then what can you say about this graph? Supposing there are no edges from the vertex set of H into X bar.
Yeah, it must be disconnected graph.
Then the whole graph is disconnected.
Okay, right? Never mind. Okay, sorry.
Great. No, that's a good point. That is actually one of the things we need to discuss. So let H and J denote distinct components in this induced subgraph induced by X. Okay? Note that partial of the vertex set of H and partial of the vertex set of J are both non-empty. Since what we just discussed, the graph is connected. If the graph was not connected, then H, for example, would be a connected component in the whole graph. So it would not be connected with vertices in J, for example. Okay, so there has to be some edge going from H to the other side, and there has to be some edge going from J to the other side. And that is true for every component on both sides of the graph. Okay? So now what shall we do? Can somebody tell me how do I find a smaller cut that is contained in the cut partial x?
Yeah, you can take the cut corresponding to a connected component.
Exactly. Exactly. Observe that if you take the cut corresponding to any component, for example, H, that is properly contained in the cut we are looking at, partial of x, and it is non-empty. It is non-empty because we have already discussed that. And it is properly contained because, well, clearly it is contained in x, right? Because all edges in the first cut, this guy, the left one, they also belong to the partial of x. Because every edge with one end in h, the other end has to be in x bar. So one end is in x and the other end is in x bar, right? So that's clear. And the proper subset property is also true, since we have two components. So if you look at one of the edges in J, in partial of J, that will not be in partial of H, since any edge E in partial of the J subgraph does not belong to Are there any questions about the first direction? So what does it mean? We have found a cut and that is non-empty. So that implies that partial x is not a bond. And that proves one direction. So now let's prove the other direction. Again, we'll do contrapositive. Supposing we have a cut that is not a bond, then we need to show that one of the two sides has to be a disconnected graph, has to induce a disconnected graph. Suppose partial x is not a bond. So our goal is to show that at least one of G induced by X and G induced by X bar is disconnected. Okay. So let's make a quick drawing. Supposing, let me use two colors now. Supposing this is my x and x bar, so I've got a bunch of edges. Okay, we know that this is not a bond, partial of x is not a bond. That means that there is some cut that is contained in it. So there exists a partial of y, which is a subset of partial of x, a proper subset, and it is not empty. Okay? Okay, so which means that there is some edge in particular. Let's say I fix one edge just for now, and I say that this edge is in partial y. So that means that one of the ends of the edge is in y, and the other end is in y bar. So I can adjust notation because y and y bar are symmetric. I can assume that this end is in y and this end is in y bar. adjust notation so that what this means is that x intersection y is non-empty and x bar intersection y bar is non-empty, because I pick one edge and I consider one end to be in y and the other end in y bar. Otherwise, I just swap y and y bar. Okay, so I'm not doing anything fancy here. I'm just making a very simple, without loss of generality statement. Is everybody clear why we can do this? I did not write down the whole argument. Okay, so now I want to make a drawing which is more useful to us. So let's suppose our cut y, we can draw a general drawing. We will get four quadrants as we got last time. Right? So this is x intersection y, this is x bar intersection y, x bar intersection y bar, and x intersection y bar. What we know is that this is not an empty set and this is not an empty set by the argument we just did, right? Okay. Are there any questions or concerns at this point? Is everybody with me? Okay. So I'm quite used to using adjust notation, and if that's not something you're used to, it's basically without loss of generality. In other courses, you might have seen this, right? So you're not really making an assumption. You're just assuming something because all other cases are symmetric to that case. All right. So now I want to make a few claims. First claim, there cannot be any edges going from x intersection y to x intersection y bar. No edge. Well, maybe I'll introduce some notation. The edges going between x intersection y and x intersection y bar, this is the empty set.
For partial of x.
Exactly. So for disjoint sets SNT, so this is some notation. The E of S comma T is all edges with one end in S and other end in T. Okay, so the claim is that there are no such edges. Well, can anybody, Aranya probably already mentioned, if there is such an edge that crosses the green line, what does it mean? It means that it is in partial y, but it is not crossing the red line, which means it is not in partial of x, right? And that cannot happen.
Green line exactly. Cross the red line.
Exactly. Every green line has to cross the red line. Any line that crosses the green line has to cross the red line. That is a visual way of looking at it. If you are confused by the visual way, notice that x is in both sides. So this edge will not be in partial of x, but it will be in partial of y. So proof is that such an edge would be in partial of y, but not in partial of x. But we know that partial y is a subset of partial of x. So that is a contradiction. Okay, so I will put a cross on this. There are no edges of this type. Okay, and now by a similar argument, analogous argument, you cannot have edges here either. So, claim 2, there are no edges between x bar intersection y and x bar intersection y bar. same proof, right? Okay. We are almost done. We need to show that one of these two sides is disconnected. Okay. So we already know that these two are empty sets. These two are non-empty. These two quadrants are non-empty, right? We will argue that at least one of the other two quadrants is non-empty. So claim three, either X intersection Y bar is non-empty or X bar intersection Y is non-empty. Possibly both, right? Why is this a claim we want to show? Before we prove it, why will this help? Can anybody tell me?
Sir, this is because if we can indeed show that either X intersection Y bar or X bar intersection Y is non-empty. So suppose X intersection Y bar is non-empty, then we know that there cannot be an edge with one endpoint in X intersection Y and the other endpoint in X intersection Y bar, because partial of Y is subset of partial of X. Then we can say that the X intersection Y and the X intersection Y bar, they are two separate connected components of induced subgraph on X.
Okay. Yeah, that's so almost correct. They need not be connected components. They could be a bunch of connected components, each of them.
Yeah. Means there will be at least two connected components.
Yeah. The point is that the graph induced by X will be disconnected. So just to repeat that point, we know that this top left quadrant is non-empty. There are some vertices here. Could be just one vertex, I don't care. If we show that there are some vertices in the top, in the left bottom corner, supposing this is non-empty, but there are no edges going between the bottom left and the top left. Well, that means that the whole left quadrant, the left side, it has to be a disconnected graph, right? If you look at just that graph, there are no edges going from bottom to top. That must mean that the two quadrants are actually disconnected from each other. Okay? So that's it. So suppose X intersection Y bar is empty and X bar intersection Y is also empty. So we are trying to prove by contradiction. Supposing both of these quadrants are empty. So let's try to see what happens. This is empty and this is empty. Can anybody tell me what happens in this case? Someone else, please. Supposing both of these quadrants are empty, then what can you conclude? What can you say about the sets X and Y?
Same.
Yeah, Krishnan, go ahead.
Yeah, so should they be the same?
Exactly, they will be the same sets. Observe, if both of these quadrants are empty, it means that X is just the top left quadrant and Y is just the top left quadrant, which means X is equal to Y is equal to X intersection Y, right? If this is true, then X is the same as Y is the same as X intersection Y. In particular, X and Y are the same, and that means that partial X is equal to partial Y, but that's not possible because partial Y is a proper subset of partial X, right? This is a contradiction again. Okay, so this completes claim 3's proof. And now, because one of these two quadrants has to be non-empty, let us suppose without loss of generality that this is non-empty. Then it means that by the discussion we already had, the graph induced by the set X is disconnected. So adjust notation so that X intersection Y bar is not empty. This implies that the graph induced by X is disconnected. And that's the end of the proof.
Sir, can you once again just repeat the proof? Why either one of them must be non-empty? It's fully clear to me.
Right, sure. Well, okay. Let me convince you by the figure for now, and you can convince yourself further. Okay? Supposing both of these sets are empty. Okay? So we are considering the case where this quadrant is empty and this quadrant is also empty. The important thing to note that is that this figure that we have drawn is as general as it gets. If you look at two bipartitions of the vertex set, you basically get four quadrants. Do you agree with that?
Yes.
Right? So this figure is completely general. We are not making any assumptions here. If both of these quadrants are empty, then observe that X is just X intersection Y. Because the bottom left quadrant is empty.
I got it. If both of these are empty, then Y will be equal to X and Y bar will be equal to X bar. Then in that case, right, partial of Y will be equal to partial of the contradiction.
Right, exactly. Yeah?
Okay.
Okay?
Okay, okay.
Any other questions or concerns? Right, so this basically completes the proof of the theorem, which says that a cut is a bond in a connected graph if and only if both the shores induce connected subgraphs. Okay. Good. So we have only a few more minutes left. I want to state one last result that will be a do-it-yourself. So theorem 2.14, you might recall that an even subgraph is nothing but a disjoint union of cycles. And this implies that the cycles generate the cycle space. Using the cycles, you can generate any even subgraph. In the same spirit, a set of edges of a graph is a cut if and only if it is a disjoint union. Any guesses? What should be the corresponding state thing here?
It could be bonds.
Disjoint union of bonds, exactly. Right? And the proof is very similar to our earlier proof for cycles and even subgraphs. So I will just say do it yourself using induction and corollary 2.12, which states that the symmetric difference of any two cuts is another cut. Okay. Good. And an implication of this that we basically just mentioned is that the bonds of a graph generate its bond space, which is basically the collection of all cuts of the graph. And this is the notation for bond space. Okay. So are there any questions or concerns? Yeah, go ahead.
So basically, sir, just a cycle generates the event subgraph. So bonds basically generate the cards.
Exactly. Right. Okay. So we don't have too much time. So I don't want to start the next module today. We'll start the next module on Wednesday. I will just briefly summarize what we have covered in this module. So the preliminaries is module zero. And this is what we are discussing right now is module one, which is the cuts, cycle space and the bond space of a graph. Okay, so I'll just write down a brief summary of this. And I will tell you some things that are on your assignment just to give a closure to this topic. So we started by talking about the edge space of a graph. And this is basically the same as GF2 with m in m dimensions, right? And we studied two subspaces of this that are generated by a graph or that are induced by a graph, if I may. It's a cycle space and the bond space, right? These are all the even subgraphs. And these are all cuts, right? And their names are due to the fact that these are generated by cycles. And these are generated by bonds. Okay, these are minimal non-empty even subgraphs and minimal non-empty cuts, respectively. Okay, on assignment one, you will be showing a few things. I'm mentioning some of the important things here. One thing you'll be showing is that these spaces are actually orthogonal complements of each other. So that means you have to show two things, that cycle space is the orthogonal complement of the bond space and vice versa, because that doesn't come for free. And two, the dimension of the cycle space of a graph is m minus n plus 1, and the dimension of the bond space you can calculate from here is n minus 1, because we know that the dimensions of the two subspaces have to add up to n. The dimension of the cycle space and the dimension of the bond space add up to n. Okay, and that's basically all I want to say about this module. And next module we're going to start is connectivity. Also, I forgot to mention the sections from Bondimurthy that correspond to what we are covering, so I will mention it now. So all of this stuff is mostly sections 2.4 to 2.6. Okay, I'm telling you this just so that if you want to do some extra reading or you want to revise some of these concepts or view them in a different light, you can take a look at the book if you have it. You don't really need it. In fact, I'm not even presenting it in the same way as it is in the book. I'm mostly using the book to get the contents and the specific theorems. But the actual proofs are not always the same as those in the book, which is good, because then you might have two different proofs to look at. Okay? And connectivity, we are going to be covering from sections I'll mention all the sections. It's from a bunch of different chapters, 3.2, 3.5, 5.1 to 5.3, and finally 9.1 to 9.4, which is the whole chapter on connectivity. Okay? So that's it for today. Any questions or concerns?
I have actually question from assignment one.
Yeah, go ahead.
So basically, sir, in assignment one, there is a problem called 2A. So in the problem 2A, you have to show that any n minus 1 trivial cards generate the bond space. So basically, by this we mean that if we take any bond, if we take any cut of the graph, edge cut of the graph, then there will exist some subset of those n minus 1 trivial cards whose symmetric difference will give me that particular edge cut.
That's right.
Okay.
That's right.
So basically, at a time, we don't need to take the symmetric difference of all the trivial cuts, of all the n minus 1 trivial cuts.
No, there is a subset of those n minus 1 trivial cuts. You can choose any n minus 1 trivial cuts, but some subset of that will generate any cut you want. Right? So for any cut, so you fix a cut and you show that there is some subset of the n minus 1 trivial cuts that will generate that particular cut you have in mind.
So basically the n minus 1 trivial cuts we are picking, that is fixed. But to generate a particular edge cut, we are picking a subset of the n minus 1 trivial cuts.
Exactly.
Symmetric difference means the symmetric difference of the subset elements. The subset element will give me a particular edge cut.
That's right.
So basically we have to show this.
Yeah.
Okay.
Good. Any others? Right, so the assignment one has been announced. I hope most of you have seen it by now. And it is due on 24th, which is Tuesday at 11 p.m. So that's Tuesday, we don't have a lecture. So it's a good day to try to make assignments due. So I'll try to do that. And then hopefully we start something fresh on a Wednesday or something like that. Let's see. So I think you have about 9.5 days or something.
No, and also sir, I have a question in problem 3 of assignment 1. So in that question, can I directly apply Veblen's theorem?
Which theorem?
Veblen's theorem. Because
Veblen's theorem, okay.
You can directly use Veblen's theorem in either of the parts. There will be no problem.
This is problem 3, right?
Yeah, problem 3 is.
Yeah, there you can.
So, in any of the parts, you can directly apply Veblen's theorem.
Sure. I mean, problems 1 and 2, I think I mentioned, I want you to not use any fancy theorems. I want you to prove it from first principles. But for the other problems, unless it's mentioned not to use something, you can use it.
Okay. As long as the result has been proved in the class.
That's right. And if there's anything you want to use that has not been done in the class, you can just send me a query and I can let you know. Maybe I'll stop recording, but I'm still here.